Assalamu alaikum students, welcome to another lecture, lecture number 1515. How are you students? You all right? How is your TEFL and other subjects are proceeding? You're doing well in all subjects? Good, good. Students, it's very important semester in your the course that you are proceeding. It's the third semester and you will be in the fourth semester very soon. So these two semesters in this program, in the master's program, they are very important. Why they are important? Because more practical courses, you know, we universities offer in the third semester and also in the final semester. And secondly, this semester is important because you enhance your pace of learning. Because in the first semester, yes, students take time. Why? Because they move from annual system of examination to semester system of examination. So definitely that takes time when you change the system. So you have to adjust yourself. So at times you find it hard, but once you spend a semester, right, and of course another semester, so then things become easy for you. And for you particularly, of course, once you have the first semester and maybe it was new for you, a new experience for you, right, you are the student of virtual the COMSAT. So definitely, you know, and in the second semester would have been better for you as compared to the first one. And now the third one, definitely now you have experience of two semesters. You have spent almost 1 year with this university. So the point is, now you are in the third semester and you, of course, I'm sure you are enjoying these courses that are being offered to you. And all courses are really important. And particularly this course, the TEFL course, right? I mean, because, you know, this course really helps you and you find it more practical, that once you will be in the market, and then this course would definitely be helping you, right, in proceeding your job. I mean, whatever job you seek, and particularly if you will be in education in the industry, you will be teaching English at different levels. So these the methods that we have talked about, or we will talk about, and you see whatever other the topics will be discussed. So will be very, very practical for you, provided you try to know them well and you try to apply them also. If you are a practicing teacher, try these techniques that we have talked about so far, or we will be talking about in future, and see that how effective these techniques are, and how can you improve your teaching. And you see, once you practice these techniques and see the result also, if you find that the learners become happy, and if you find that learners are learning more, and if you feel that that of course the pace of learning of foreign language has increased, so this it means that is a success. And again, it is not hard and fast that when you apply a method and you see you bring the 100% result. Every method, I always say, that have some problems. Of course, no method is an accurate method, but you see, I mean, every method has positive points. So, but provided we know the method, provided we know again that what are the techniques and what are the principles of this method and how we can use it. So it all depends. You see, once you will be in the practical life, you will see that these techniques will be helping you. And again, these techniques are not the final that we have. You can have many more techniques that you can exploit in the class, and that those techniques can be a real success. The ultimate purpose is, of course, to help the learner to learn the foreign language, and again to help the learner communicate in that language, because that is the purpose of the language. So if the learner is unable to communicate, and it means that there was something wrong with that, with the methodology, and methodology needs improvements. This is what the objective of this course. I told you the very first day, to help you facilitate, in fact, language teaching particularly, and of course with skills, all four skills: reading, writing, listening and speaking. For that we are trying to what? Build a foundation for it. And this is the part of the foundation that we started with, what is the TEFL first, and then we moved on to what is the scope of TEFL, and then we started different methods, right, of foreign language teaching. And I hope now you, by this time, you have an idea that what are different these methods are, and why we are, I mean, we're talking about these methods, what is the significance of these methods, and how these methods or how these ways, either they are, either is there a direct method out there, or silent way is there, or the CLL is there, how these methods can improve our foreign language teaching, particularly our English language teaching, and you will see the improvement if you see these techniques, because I mean people have been talking about, and the teachers of the English language, they have been using these methods, of course, for ages, and they have been successful, right? They have been successful. For example, talking about the recent method we talked about before CLL, that was Suggestopedia. Yes, and we discussed a lot that method really student like most, and also the teachers. Teachers have, in fact, teachers support that method, that this method is there, where the teacher gets tired, but the point is that the learning pace is more. So, of course, if you want to be a successful English language teacher, these methods would definitely help you. In fact, these methods give you a platform so that you can be on sound footing, and you can face the class successfully, and of course, you can face the interviewer successfully, provided you know these things. And this is what the more practical is. If you want to make your career in education industry, of course, in the training particularly, so you can, I mean, these methods that we have talked about so far, really successful, and also we'll be talking about, will really help you more. Mind you, of course, whatever techniques are there, they are really the practical. You can apply them and see, and they're not from the sky. Clear, students? You understand? Are you with me? So that's why, of course, you need to be motivated, and of course, I mean, feel that you have opted for a right course and you are doing well, right? So this is, inner motivation is very important. You need not to say that you are pursuing a course which is not in demand. I tell you, your course is highly in demand, but definitely it will be in demand provided you people put something to it, you people work really hard, right, to make worth of this degree. Mind you, I always say that student makes worth of a degree. Degree does not make your worth. So if you are pursuing this degree, you are student of the TEFL, you have opted this course, and you may do research in this course particularly. So, but the point is that you will add value to it, you will put efforts, you will read more, and you will in fact observe more, right? And then a time will come that you will have a lot of activities to explore in the class, and you will be running short of time to incorporate every activity that you are planning to. So this is what, how would you achieve it? You can only achieve it if you work hard, if you take this subject seriously, and if you really really enjoy this subject, then you can in fact achieve your goals. And I tell you that if you want to make your career in this world, yeah, you can do that. The world is open, of course, means international language and opportunities for this language teachers particularly, and of course the speakers of this language are of course there in the world. I mean you can apply for jobs. Clear? You understand? Ready for it? All right, so good. Feel that you are pursuing a very good degree, a very good program, and this will pay you back, and whatever you are investing in, the time, the money, fine, it will pay you back. You will not be disappointed, but for that you have to work really hard. You have to compete with the students, mind you. I tell you, you have to compete with the students of different universities, so you will be at par with those students if you work hard. And definitely, I tell you, students, that the hard work pays you back. In fact, it is the hard work that makes the difference. So success, fine, of course, this hard work is success too, is a key to success. Fine, so put efforts, work hard, right? I mean, read as much as you can, observe as much as you can, interact with people as much as you can, right? Google out, you see things, research on this topics. There is a lot of material available on the TEFL, particularly the new techniques of the TEFL. So for all that, you have to spare time. Clear? So let's start today. What is it? Lecture number 15. And which method are you talking about? Oh, great, CLL. You might be thinking why I have given more importance to CLL. Okay, yeah, it's a good question, my dear student. Well, it's an important method, in fact. And particularly the area that today we are talking about, it's really important. Today we'll see, we'll review, right? What we'll review? The principles. Again, we'll try to answer those 10 questions, TIQ, 10 important questions. And we'll see, we'll review those principles, and then we'll also see some techniques that can be used in this method. Shall we start? All right. Well, students, so let's start this lecture. So as our routine, whenever we start our next lecture, we first of all, we review the last lecture. Let's review the previous lecture. But today I won't review for you. I ask you to review the lecture. So see here. Yes. Who would give me summary of the last lecture? It was about CLL. All right. So what important areas we covered in that lecture? Remember that? Okay. Good. We talked about observations and principles. Good. So my dear students, I gave you observations and you people gave me principles. Good. All right. So can I take your test today? Ready? Okay. Let's have an oral quiz. A non-credit one. You will get your credit quiz later on. But see, a quiz today. I give you observation and I want you to give me principle. Okay, teacher enters the class and he greets the students. What he does? He greets the students. Give me a principle behind. Try. Think. Okay. Yes. You want me to repeat? Okay, I repeat for you, my dear students. The teacher enters the class and what he does? He greets the students. He says, "Hello, students. How are you?" And he greets also NL1. Aap kaise hain students? Talaba, aap kaise hain? Aap log theek hain? See? So, in this, we see in the Indonesian language, in our text, the teacher greets the students. G, what is the principle behind? Relation building. Okay, teacher is friendly. Good, fine. So, it means you had an idea. All right, another observation, right? So what you need to give me what? Principle. Okay, students have conversation in the class. I give you again, the observation is that students have conversation in the class. What is the principle behind? Okay, language is for communication. Very good, student. Very good. Shall I give you another observation? All right. Okay. Now, the observation is that the teacher reads script for 3 times. The teacher reads the script for 3 times and the student relax. What is the principle behind? Principle behind is, yes, what is the principle? Yes, fine, good. That students, a relaxed mind learns faster. Good, so that's good, that's good. My dear students, good. Done a good job. We got 3 out of 3 in this quiz. All right. So, dear students, my dear students, in the last lecture, we talked about observations and we inferred, in fact, principles from those observations. We talked that a teacher comes in the class and the teacher greets and principle behind is what? Relation building. And where we saw that the teacher have students have conversation in the class, they talk in the class, so language is for communication. And then we also saw in the class that, well, what the teacher does, he in fact asks the students to have their voice record. Fine, and the students record their voices and teacher uses and the teacher transcribes those the script, fine, the dialogue of the students, and then we use that transcript in activities. Then we also saw in the last lecture that what happens, yeah, if the student in fact the teacher repeats, fine, incorrect expression of a student without making him realize that he has made a mistake. So once student listen to it, he corrects himself. So this is, of course, we had a detailed discussion on these principles and observations, and I hope now you have an idea, my dear students, that what is an activity and what is the principle behind. Again, I would say that this method is comprised of your techniques in the class, activities in the class, and what the point is, the principle. Okay, there's a question. Yes, what is the question? What is this activity? Okay, fine. Well, activity upon the word act, right? So whatever actions we do in the class, we make our students do in the class, fine, we direct our students to do, these are activities, and these are, of course, creative activities are there. So that's why our teacher should be creative. Fine, I mean, teaching a foreign language definitely needs a creative mind, and you need to be creative. It doesn't mean that, of course, we cannot be teacher because you are not creative. Yeah, you can create things, of course, create the purpose, you know. The purpose, the principle should be behind every activity. The principle behind, you should know the principle that why you are using that activity, that if you are having this activity, which skill of language you want to focus on, and which area of language you want your learners to improve. So that you should know that how activity is, I mean, how activity and principle they are aligned, and of course how the principle is behind this, the activity. So whatever activity you design, you need to be clear, your mind should be clear that why you are using this activity and what is the principle behind and what is the method behind. Is that clear? So this is what that the word act and activity, and we can also call them techniques, and even of course in the modern world we may call it strategies, the classroom strategies also. Clear? All right. So that is what I mean. I didn't give you summary, rather you gave me the summary, and of course I asked you some of the co-questions and you replied. So in the simple, in last lecture we talk about observations and principles. Of course, today's lecture we'll try to review those TIQ tick, and particularly why I say that we have allocated one lecture for this, because these 10 questions in fact are really, of course, answered. You see, these 10 questions need much interpretation, so that's why we need more time for these principles. Let's see those 10 questions. Who would tell me those 10 questions? Remember that? Goals of a teacher, role of a teacher, all right, interaction in the class, characteristics of teaching learning process, fine. What else? Role of native language, students' native language, fine. How evaluation is done, how errors are responded, what else? Which areas of language are focused on, which skills of language are focused on, right? Good, good. That abbreviation, of course, really helps you. GRICLA, fine, and then what? LANEE, remember that? Good, mean the goals, right, of a teacher using that language, role of a teacher, role of a student, then interaction between the two teacher and student, in fact, and then what? Characteristics of teaching learning the process, fine, and then which areas of language are focused, which skills are highlighted. And then what is the role of students' native language, fine, and how evaluation is done, and also how errors are dealt with, fine, clear, how errors are responded. Let's start, students. Of course, you hear me well, students. So the first question is that what are the goals of a teacher using CLL method. Again, I remind you, my dear students, that after every method you need to answer these questions so that you would be clear, right, that what are the goals of a teacher using that particular method. At the end of GTM you could do the same, at the end of Silent Way, at the end of Audiolingual, at the end of Suggestopedia, what at the end of communicative language teaching. So whatever method that you incorporate, that you use for your foreign language teaching, at the end of that method, even in your text, you will find that first the writer talks about the principles, he gives you observation, then he gives you principle, and first he takes you to a classroom where you see the class, right? And then he reviews those principles, and then he comes to the technique. So of course, that's why today we are here, to review those principles. In other words, to answer those short questions. So first question was that what are the goals of a teacher using CLL, Community Language Learning? So first goal is to help learners use target language communicatively. Like you saw that, of course, that language is for communication. And if the communication is there, if you are able to communicate in that language, it means you know that language. So language is for the sake of communication. And on the other hand, if you are unable to communicate in the language, it means you need to work on that language. You don't know that language. So the purpose of that language is what? Communication. And that's why the spoken version, right? There are two versions of language. One is the spoken version, another is the written version. So spoken version is that language that we use for communication. In fact, written is of course the formal way when you have to write a message. Though they are communication, one is written communication and second is oral communication. So since we see that the goal of this method is to help the students, to help the learners to communicate, right, in the target language, which language in our case, for example, English language. Fine. So we being TEFL teachers, if you use CLL, so your goal can be to help your students, fine, to communicate in this, the target language. So this is of course, and then to help students know about their own learning. This is important. That definitely what they have learned. See, and you know that all learning is self-learning, in fact. And of course, students learn if, and for that, inner motivation is important, right? So also the point is that to this method, the community language learning, I mean, yes, the teacher also help, the goals of teacher to know, in fact, to help students know what? Their own learning, about their own learning, that how much they have learned, in fact, right? So how much they already, in fact, the students knew, and what value addition they had. So first of all, to help learners communicate in the target language, and second is to help students know about their own learning, that what they have really, really learned, what they have really, really owned. Because you can own the learning if you can use that. If you have learned, of course, an expression, and you see you can use in your community with the help of your with your colleagues, so you can, again, it's a goal of the learner, right? And then of course, students, well, to have teaching learning process in non-defensive manner. This is important, right? We had a discussion also on that. This is another goal of the teacher, that to have learning in which manner? Non-defensive manner. And Charles A. Curran, of course, was that? Yeah, of course, Charles A. Curran. So his theory, of course, that theory was learning, adult learning approach. And definitely this theory, of course, CLL, definitely takes some principles from Curran's theory. Fine. And Curran has studied adult learning approaches. So this theory, in fact, definitely takes some practices from the Curran's theory, in fact. So that's what point is, that what the goal is, to have teaching learning in a non-defensive manner. And I hope you remember the last lecture where we talk about six elements of non-defensive learning. And we might have discussion today on non-defensive learning, that what is this non-defensive learning. And since Charles the Curran, in fact, studied adult learning approaches, and it's very clear, and you know it well, that the adult have some problems in learning. So that can be, of course, their fear, their insecurity, and their, of course, fear that they will mispronounce and all that. So that's why the goal is to help learners to have what? Non-defensive learning. So three goals are there. The first goal is to have learner communicate in this target language. Second, to have learner, one, yes, know about their own learning. And second, to have teaching learning process in non-defensive manner, where that the learner would not be threatened, right? He would not be insecure, of course. Now, who wants students here? Now, that was the goals of the teacher. Remember these goals, right? Because we'll be repeating those goals later on, so these goals should be, you should know them, right? Should be on your tips, that, well, to help the learner communicate in the target language, to help the learner know his own learning. And third one is to have this teaching learning process in non-defensive manner. Fine? Now, what are the roles of the teacher and the student, in fact? We just saw goals of the teacher, right, using this method. Now, the role of the teacher and the student. Fine? What are the roles of the student, teacher, in fact? And you know, I should not tell you that here, you know, that counselor, the word, you know that? Last lecture we talked about the teacher's role, which is a counselor. Again, it's a very important thing that who is a counselor, right? Right? So one who give you counsels, right? And how give he counsels? Without hurting you, in fact. And he understands your problem, right? And whenever he feels that you are struggling somewhere, so he takes the charge. In fact, he comes forward and he helps you out. So the relation is what? What do we call it? The counselor and client relation, right? And the approach, you know, is what? Client-centered approach, or in other words, student-centered approach, or in other words, audience-centered approach, where we cares, right? What we care for, or the teacher cares for the needs, wants of our learner. So is the case here. The role of teacher, he is a counselor. He give counseling, in fact, right? So that's the teacher in this community language learning. Teacher role is he is a counselor. Now, what is the role of the student, my dear student, in this one? Right? So, the role of a student is initially dependent. Right? So, initially, of course, we say that he depends on the teacher, and of course, the teacher writes, the student, we saw in the class that the student, give their, of course, expression in their mother tongue, and the teacher translates, in fact. And even at times, teacher asks for input and the students remain quiet. Nobody volunteers, right? So that is what that's initially, in the initial phases, students are more dependent. Slowly and gradually, right, once they get to know about different things, they gain confidence, right, they have ideas, of course. So then they move from that what dependence to independence. So that is the role of this the student, is that initially it is what, right, depend on the teacher, client of the counselor, in fact. And then learner becomes dependent after some time if he continues studying. If he continues putting effort, you will see that he becomes independent. So this is what the role of the teacher. So teacher is, sorry, the role of the student. So the role of the teacher is counselor, and role of the student is, yes, initially dependent, and then he becomes independent. So if I encapsulate this, what the role of the teacher and student in CLL, my dear students, so in simple words, I will tell you that teacher is a counselor, he gives counseling, right? And the relation with the student is counselor-client relation. Fine, and you know it well that, of course, how a counselor, in fact, gives the counseling, how he takes care of his client, and how he helps his clients come out of the problems, right? So in this is what, because he is the client, and if he fails to, right, help his client, so definitely client will leave him, in fact. So again, if you see in the business world, then of course, whenever you see you are in the business world and the customer comes to you, your client comes to you, so definitely you have to serve him, you have to facilitate him, you have to give him your best services. And if you are in private sector, definitely in our country, of course, so you have to go an extra mile. Otherwise, there is open competition. There are a lot of businesses available, so do that customer will leave you alone, right? So that's why this is client-customer relations are there. So student is, initially he is dependent, and then he becomes independent. So again, this the role that the CLL, of course, suggests, five stages from dependency to independency. Now, you can ask the question that how a student starts. Initially, he is dependent, and how many phases are there where he reached that the final stage of what, where he becomes independent. So there are five stages. You will see it. In the fourth stage, fine, that what happens, the role switch, right, where from dependence to independence, the role switch, and the student no longer needs the teacher's encouragement and absolute sense of security. In fact, initially students in fact need security, but later on, once you feel that, yeah, so in the fourth stage, what happens that the role shift and the students move towards that independency. Fine, students? All right. So the third thing is, first thing, the goals of a teacher. What are goals of teacher student? Remember that? To have learners communicate in the target language. Good. Second thing, to have learners to understand their own learning. Good. Third thing, what is the third goal of the teacher? Remember that? No? You forgot? Oh, no, this is not fair. You can go back to see the slide. Okay. So, simple, of course, the goals I gave you. And then what is the role of a teacher? All right, teacher is a counselor. Good. And role of a student? All right, student is initially is dependent, and then he moves to independence. And that, see, this movement from dependence to independence, there are phases, there are five phases, five steps are there. In the fourth phase, this role shifts. Fine. Okay, now the third thing. So what are the characteristics of this teaching learning process? So we have different stages. So first, see, there is a conversation between what? Students and teachers, right? We see that teacher enters the class and he greets. And then later what happens? Transcript is made. The student teacher asks the students to have their voice record in that player that they have. So the transcript is made. And then that transcript is used as a text. So this is, see, that syllabus initially, that the student designed the syllabus. So syllabus is designed with the help of the student. And student, whatever the student say, the teacher records that, of course. Teachers have that voice recorded. And then, you know, I mean, what later activities are done on that. So then the text, that, of course, the transcript becomes the text. And who transcribes this? Again, the teacher transcribed in the, of course, from that L1 to L2. And then various activities, of course, are done, which include what? The grammar, pronunciation, right? And others, of course, I mean, the students are allowed to explore many other activities on that. For example, students may be asked to find out the antonyms of these words. Students may be asked to find out synonyms of these words, of course. Students may be asked to, in fact, to put them in, of course, I mean, to know their, I mean, the word classes and all that. So later, once that the transcript is done, is made, fine, and students use it, and then for they may be allowed to of course explore more languages on that. In fact, so here, I mean, again, if we move on, what are the other characteristics? Yeah, there are six elements, of course, necessary for non-defensive learning. Since the learning is, my dear students, non-defensive learning in the CLL, that of course it takes. So what are we talking about? Yeah, we're talking about the learning is non-defensive learning. And what is non-defensive learning? Simple, the name shows that when learning is non-defensively, that the learner, of course, the learner feels at ease, he is comfortable, right? So that is mean, point is that he has no fear, right? So that learning, of course, is what non-defensive learning, when the learner is not insecure. So there are some elements of, six elements are there of non-defensive learning. And Curran, of course, George Curran gave these six elements. So these are, I mean, these six elements, my dear students, they in fact make your learning, non-defensive learning. What are these elements? It's an important point. Yeah. Again, you want me to repeat? Okay. Non-defensive, opposite of defensive. When you become defensive, for example. So in this learning is that you are not defensive, for example, right? You take it easily, in fact. You take it, I mean, comfortably, right? There is no the pressure on you. There is no fear. You are not insecure, right? So that learning is non-defensive learning. And these Curran's six elements are there. And these six elements make this learning, in a real sense, what? Non-defensive learning. What are these elements, students? So first element, one is security, in fact. That learner should be secure. Now, your question can be that how a learner can be secure. So we saw in the class, you see, that the teacher begins in L1. So this also gives security to this to the learner, right? But he has no, of course, insecurity that well, the point is that if I don't know how to talk in the target language, I'll be in trouble. So yes, so he is provided security that he has. I mean, of course, a leverage he has. He can, of course, instructions are there in L1. So first one is security, and then aggression. You know, definitely non-defensive learning students. Sometimes they are allowed to assert themselves. Definitely, of course, mind you that different situations of a language definitely demand a different expression. At time you become angry, at time you are very happy, at time you are polite, right? At time you are tired, right? So at time you are fearing. Of course, you see you have fear, fine. So this varies. Is that clear? So different. I mean, of course, in your life, different. You have to express your emotions. You express your happiness. You express your sadness, right? You express your firmness, right? And you express your what? Shyness sometimes. See, so whatever. For this, you need different language expressions. Fine. So that's why. And sometimes you have to be aggressive. Whatever. Now, this is my point, and it is a final point. No compromise would be there on it. What is it? Aggression. So this is what also mean. One, that the first one is security, and the second one is aggression, my dear students. That she should be given opportunity to assert themselves. And you know, some the students start conversating, of course. They converse with one another. So what happens? Then at that time, the teacher withdraws, in fact. He let the students communicate, in fact, and he let them use their expressions. And at time, if you feel that students start struggling, he comes and facilitates them, in fact. So that is also aggression. Then attention, of course, right? The student, the teacher gives them attention. And also student, definitely, you know, it's a cooperation, so attention is required on either side. Reflection, whatever they have learned, of course, they have to reflect back. Like you see, when the students give their experience, so again, they reflect their experience in L2. On one hand, they express their feelings, and then they reflect those feelings in L2. So that's also mean that non-defensive learning is that a learner reflects back, a learner says. If learner does not reflect, maybe he is shy, he is reluctant, he has a fear. So we have to remove those barriers that the learner would be able to reflect back. If the learner fails to reflect back, so it means that the learning is not non-defensive learning. There are some of the barriers that the learner that feels. So we have to make it, reflection is also an important element of non-defensive learning. Then retention also, right? You retain, you absorb, of course. So you need to, you should be able to retain things, absorb things, right? So that you would make use of that expression in your communication, in fact. So see, what is it? First of all, there is security. Second, aggression, attention, retention. You retain. Retain means you keep with you, in fact. And then, like, you retain employees, for example. These days, the biggest challenges the organizations face that employees do not retain. So a learning, of course, non-defensive learning is that when the learner learns something and he can retain that. And you can only return if it is, you can only retain if it is meaningful learning. If it is not meaningful, if you have a superficial idea of something, so then you cannot retain. Maybe after a while you will forget that. There are some, the learners, they learn things, but after a while they forget. So that's why the CLL, of course, talks about non-defensive learning, the learning which gives you security, and which in fact helps you to reflect back, which gives you attention, like it's a community. So both the teacher and student, they give attention to one another, distrust each other, they respect each other, in fact, right? And then, of course, they would be able to discriminate between different forms of the language. Even there's a form of the verb, you should be able to discriminate that which is the base form, the past participle form, and also, definitely, of course, or it's the present participle form, or there are different forms of the language, they should be able to differentiate between forms, they should be able to differentiate between functions. Is that clear? So these are some, what do we call them, elements of what? See, non-defensive learning. Yes, students? So now the next question is, nature of teacher-student interaction and the nature of student-student interaction. What is it? Right? Okay, fine, it's good that you know it, that teacher-student interaction changes with the lesson and over time, right? Initially, you see that, of course, I mean, initially, of course, the both, that the teacher, in fact, I mean, the student depend on the teacher, so definitely interaction is there, the more interaction. You know that, of course, the role of a teacher moves from dependency to independence. So that's what, of course, means that you see it with the passage of time. Initially, the teacher, the students depend on the teacher, so there's no more interaction. But once the student becomes independent, of course, after some time, once he in fact continues practicing, so and then the interaction in the beginning would definitely be more, because you guys, because one depends on the other, right? And one asks the question, of course. Later, in fact, once you see that of course interaction comparatively, in fact, you can say maybe low at the later stage, when the student gains confidence. And then at times students are aggressive, right? A teacher facilitates them in the target language. Yeah, aggression is also, I mean, a function, of course, of the language. We cannot say no to it. We are human beings. At times we become aggressive. At times we become very polite, in fact. So this is what we show. And the culture is also there. You see, so at time you have to vent your feelings. If you are happy, yes, you have to show your happiness. And if you're sad, yeah, your face speaks for that. If your words speak for your sadness. So whatever, I mean, bent of mind you are, so you reflect that. So aggression is also the part of that. And the teacher just facilitate them. How can we do that? And also removes another nature of interaction is the teacher removes himself from that. Once there is conversation going on, so he just sits aside, of course. He let people communicate, in fact. Of course, this Radin, in fact, he's of the view that CLL is neither, it's a very important point, neither student-centered nor teacher-centered, but it is both the teacher and the student-centered. See, it's a very important point. I repeat, my dear students, for you, that this is a very important point, that this approach, the CLL, is neither teacher-centered nor student-centered. It is both the teacher and the student-centered. Why? Because it's a community. Right, the students, in fact, definitely they need the teacher. They depend on the teacher initially, and that's why over there, you see that initially we see that the students depend on the teacher, so it's a teacher centered. And then again, the teacher, of course, once they give confidence, again the student centered. So it is both, right? This CLL is both, as per the Radin, that this is both the teacher centered and the student-centered approach. And then, of course, relation building is there, right? And this, again, once you build relations, also helps you in what? Non-defensive learning. So this is what we say, that this is nature of the student-teacher interaction. Yes, initially more, with the passage of time, maybe less, right? And, of course, the nature of the student also, right? Student interact with one another, right? They also interact with the teacher. Initial interaction is more. So this is what the nature of the interaction between the teacher and the student and the student's interaction. How students' feelings are dealt with? It's a very important question we have been talking about since our the start of this semester. And we accept that the feelings of students are important. And you see that while teaching a foreign language, the feelings of students are to be dealt with positively. So here what we do, that students' feelings are considered important, right? And again, how they are considered important, because they are being invited to give their, in fact, to comment on how do they feel while the teachers right? So their feelings there, the teacher asks them to give their comments on that. Clear? So it means once the teacher invite their comments, so I mean we care for the feelings of the teacher, of the students. Clear? And then also student security is provided by using their native language in the class. You understand? So once the students are asked, and not once but twice, students are asked to comment on the feelings, how do they feel in the class, And students reflect, right? Again, it's a non-defensive learning. They reflect back and talk about their experience, whether it was a good or whatever. Fine. And then also, once they are insecure, they feel that they don't have language. So what they do? The students, my dear student, you see, the teacher in fact gives them, you see, help in their native language. So again, the students' feelings are dealt with positively in this method. So how language is viewed? What is language, by the way? You know it as a tool, all right, for communication. Where does language start? From sounds. Okay, good. That's why we have phonetics. Fine. So come to the method, CLL, right? So method says how language is viewed, how culture is viewed, in fact. So dear students, yeah, language for communication. Yeah, we know that, of course, the goal of the method, remember that? Yeah, the goal of the method was that to help the learner communicate in the language, to help the learner understand his own learning. Remember that? So here, of course, yes, language is viewed, language is given priority, and language is used for communication, right? And of course, the communication, the process of sharing by which messages produce response, all right? What is communication process? Okay, communicator, communicant, right, we call them sender or receiver, channel, all right, fine, feedback, okay, and the message, fine, they all take place in a particular environment. Good, good, all right. So this is what, my dear friend, we can say that, you see that how that language is what for information, and then Curran believes that of course, that learning is persons. Right, so we take students as whole person. Remember that the day one we talked about. So what is a whole person? Once you keep learn, when you consider learner as a whole person, so you consider their intellect, their in fact their feelings, their relationships, right? So all the needs of a member of a community. So you take care of that, and that's why the Curran rightly believes that learning is a person, right? So that's why the CLL, of course, highlights, of course, this principle that that the learners, of course, mean that you make a community of your students. They make a community, and you help them out in this way. Then, of course, the next is that how language is viewed. That the teacher and the taught agree to trust on one another. Yeah, trust is very important. Relation building. A community, I mean, you see, community can only be built if there is a trust, if there's a two-way process, right? So if both respect and trust each other, community can be built, in fact. And again, the focused, like see that how language is viewed, the focus is shifted, right? I mean, from grammar to what? Sharing and belonging between persons, right? Like, of course, if you just see that, well, the grammar, the form is important, so I mean the focus was on the grammatical pattern and sentence formations. But here we saw that for the first time now the focus has been shifted from grammar and sentence formation to belongings, love, relation. Is that clear? You understand? Good. Again, this Curran says, well, that language is to develop creative thinking, and culture is integrated with language, right? So this is, I mean, you can think over it, either you agree or disagree with Curran, that, well, the language is developed to develop creative thinking. In short, that language develops creative thinking. If you have language, you can be creative. So of course, if you are a good language student, if you are a good language teacher, you can be creative, in fact. So language, right, and in the hearts of heart, language, what? Develops your creativity, in fact, your creative thinking. And if you have language, only then you can be creative. Is that clear? Good. So, goals of a teacher, role of a teacher, and role of a student, right? Then characteristics of language, teaching learning process, and how language is viewed and culture is viewed. Okay, so how areas, which areas of language are emphasized? Which skills of language are emphasized? Yes, students? So, in the early stage, you know that students begin, They design the syllabus, of course, right? And later teachers can also help them in designing the books and the handouts and all that. So as far as that is concerned, that well, and then which areas, which, of course, pronunciation is focused, grammar point, vocabulary, fine. And on the basis of, I mean, how we do all these things, on the basis of what? On the basis of the definitely the transcript that the student have provided. Definitely it is transcribed by the teacher, but student have given the feedback in the beginning. So all those activities are designed on what? On that text that the student have provided in the beginning, and we make activities. Again, you can think of that why we use this text of the student, why can't we take text from other sources? Well, so natural that if you design your own text and if you work on that, you do it well, right? Your self-created, the text, in fact, motivates you to explore it, because you are, of course, behind that text. That is your idea. That is your brainchild. So if you give an idea, my dear students, so you can explore it well. You can explore it in many ways, right? So that's why in this method we saw that the students, the teacher helps them, right? Definitely students, teacher help, in fact, have their voice recorded. And then what happens? Later, other activities are designed on that given text. And student enjoy doing it, fine, because it is their script, and of course, and it is their idea, so they want to work on that, fine. So again, the role of students' native language, what is it, my dear students? Yeah, again, we saw in the beginning that yes, it is enhanced, that security is enhanced by using their native language. So yes, initially, of course, we saw that teachers begins in their native language, and it gives security to the students. And otherwise, they remain insecure. And you can observe a class where a learner comes in a language class, and he cannot speak that language, and maybe the teacher starts using that language, and of course, initially, the student finds it very hard, and he becomes insecure. So the point is that, you see, when you talk about this insecurities, so that can be overcome to some extent by switching the code, or by going to the L1 of the student, and that would, of course, really would help him. So the native language is there. Where possible, literal translation is also given, like we saw the teacher gives translation. And then, of course, later stage, more and more target language is used. Initially, yes, L1 is there. The role of native language is more initially in the early stages. Later stages, of course, the role of L1 is comparatively less, and more of both target language was there. So slowly and gradually we move, in fact, and initially the teacher, in fact, starts with that L1 and gives and translates also. And with the passage of time, you see that now this the more target language is used. Dear students, how evaluation is done? That's a good question, right? Definitely, of course, evaluation is an important part of every method. In fact, whatever method you use, whatever techniques you use, whatever activities you use, yes, you have to evaluate students at the end. So evaluation is important. Then how we can evaluate? By the way, if I ask you that, how would you evaluate students in this method particularly? Do you have an answer? Okay, write down this answer. Well, how will you evaluate students? Done. Okay, see that now, please exchange with your friends. What have you done now? Okay, so yes, students, well, it's a good attempt that you have done, that how evaluation is accomplished. So my dear, there's no particular mode of evaluation, right? Of course, is prescribed in this method. It can be, in fact, example, a teacher made classroom. Fine, you can say a teacher-made classroom would focus on what? Integrative test rather than a discrete point. There's no, this point might not be clear to you. Discrete point test mean if one area of language is tested. Example, vocabulary. There's an activity that there can be a question in the exam that just only test your vocabulary. So that is discrete point word evaluation. But this is not that discrete point evaluation, it is integrative. More than one skills, of course, are more than one areas of language are what tested. And then student would be of course to write a paragraph or be given an interview. So it can be definitely integrative, right? They can be asked to write their own profile, and then of course they can be given an interview. Is that clear? This is what mean evaluation is done. It's very important part. When you start a course, you set your objectives, and then you see that what are the goals of my of course this method I'm using, and what would be what contents would I teach, and how would I teach, and finally at the end you see that how evaluation will be done, right? So that's why you have to evaluate once you complete that course. So exam, that how does teacher respond to student errors? It's a very important point, right? That definitely response of a teacher to student. Fine. That you saw in the in this class proceeding that the teacher work with the learners in non-threatening way, right? And what is the non-threatening way? What he does, my dear students, that he lets the speaker speak, right? And if he finds that the student has made a mistake somewhere, so the teacher repeats that expression. He doesn't make the student realize that he has done something wrong. So when a teacher finds that there is something wrong, some sentence is wrong, right? So he repeats that sentence. So when the teacher repeats that sentence time and again, it's a client, right? Client counselor. Right, teacher is a counselor, so client-counselor relationship, and that's why when a client comes to you, you don't say that a client is wrong. So if you find a client is doing something wrong, so you correct yourself, you repeat that, and you feel that and client comes to know that there is something wrong, and so he in fact corrects himself. Is that clear? So this is what we do in the, that the teacher work with the student, with the learner in a non-threatening way. He never says you are wrong. Right. So if it says this, definitely, of course, I mean, it would not be a good trust building relation. Definitely, it's a community. In fact, so in community, you have to give respect. You have to trust one another. Only then the community would grow. Otherwise, it would be difficult for community to move on, to in fact grow. That's why for a successful in fact community growth, my dear students. What I mean that the trust is important, and that we see in this method as well. So teacher repeats correctly what the students has said incorrectly. This is again, right? As I said, that of course the teacher just repeats that the wrong version in a correct way. Is that clear? You understand? All right. Let's move on. All right. Now this was what these 10 questions that we have to. Answer what are these 20 questions, students? I'll review it later. Quickly have a look on these techniques which are used in this grammar translation method. Tape recording students' conversation, very important technique, my dear students. When you have students record their voices, in fact, really it helps. I mean, at least the point is that first of all, find it a good activity that their voice is there, and they feel, of course, proud that you know their voice has been recorded, and that would be used as a text for the classroom activities. So there would be more, again, I feel more involvement would be there, more attention would be there, the whole class, of course, because every student has his voice recorded. So definitely, you know, and this thing, increases involvement of the student, and they remain attentive, that they see that their voice is important and it has been recorded. And again, once they listen to their voice again, it also gives them a sense of achievement that their voice is there and the whole class is listening to the voice. Clear? So this is again a very good activity, of course, in this method and this community language learning, that voice is recorded on the tape recorder. Now you can, time has changed, you can have the latest, of course, tools to have your voice recorded, you have mobiles and all that. So it can be, and it is more easy, of course, you can do it. Then transcription, again, the teacher transcribes, of course, he writes on the board also, he transcribes in the, of course, the mother tongue, L1, in fact. And even the first, the teacher asks for the input, and if nobody volunteers, and then he transcribes again. The teacher students are dependent first, and then of course they become independent. And of course they reflect on the experience. Once they are asked, The teacher asks, how do you feel? And they reply, and they talk about their experience, they talk about their class experience. So again, mean they reflect on their experience. Clear, students? All right. So here, another technique that is used, what reflective listening, in fact. What is reflective listening, students? I mean, the word reflect, all right. I mean, the point is that reflective is simple word, of course. They reflect, you give ideas, in fact. How do you reflect? He reflected back. But here is reflective listening. Is that clear? You listen and you reflect, in fact. Fine, you listen to the voice and you reflect back, for example. So this is what another technique has been used in this method. Then, of course, computer. Whenever there was a mistake, in fact, and then there was somebody who correct, like computer, in fact. Whenever you type on computer and you see what happens, my dear students, that there a green line appears under it or a red line appears, in fact. So that shows that spellings are wrong, right? That those lines show that something is wrong there. So is the case here, right? That when you do when you communicate, and then your instructor, the teacher in the class, he helps you, in fact, of course. And then again, there are small group tasks up there. The group of three students work in group of three, in fact. So again, this gives them a sense of community. They work in a sense of a community, and you see, in this way, the learning is more, of course. Every group member helps other member, in fact, and there is no fear of anything. So this way, the learning is more, in fact. And then there are, of course, small group tasks are there, and these group tasks definitely, in fact, enhance what cooperation among the students, right? And there is no competition. Fine. So small group task, in fact, again, it's a good activity in the class. That of course that shows that it's a community, and this way learning, of course, I mean the pace of learning increases, and students in fact work together, they help one another, and again their strengths are also exchanged, because if one student is good at one skill, so he his group member can ask him for his help. And definitely, I mean, no two learners are same. Every learner has a different pace of learning, and also, I mean, retention. Every learner has a different capacity of retaining things. So some learners, they retain well and some cannot. So in this way, if they work in a small group, so they can be a helping hand for one another. They can help each other well, in fact. So these are what we call them techniques are there. Still, I want you students that please read this method. It's a very important method. Community language learning, the method is there. So let's at the end, who would give me summary? Today, you might be surprised that I didn't give you revision of the last lecture. And even I don't give you this summary of this lecture. But you know, you are active learners. Now you have done how many lectures? Today, we are going to complete 15th lecture, right? So you need to give me a summary, okay? Who would try a summary of this today's? Yes, okay. Yes, Amania, would you try? No. Salar, would you try? Try it. Yes, Anjuman, can you try? Okay, good. Okay, fine, you're thinking? All right, I'll give you my ideas, friends. Today in this lecture, students, and this, we talked about what? We talked about, yeah? We reviewed all the 10 questions, right, in the light of this CLL, right? So, how many questions? There are 10 questions. What was the first question we reviewed? We saw, what are the goals of a teacher, right? And we discussed that to help the students communicate in the language, good. Also, to help your students understand their own learning, good. And what is the role of a teacher? We saw that the teacher is a counselor, and the student, yeah, they initially they are dependent and then they become independent. Good. Interaction, yeah, of course, we see that there is interaction, of course, right? And the approach is neither student center nor teacher center, it is both teacher and student center. Good, fine. What else? teaching learning process, characteristics, fine, we talk about that. What did we say? Yeah, it's a client-counselor relationship. Fine, non-defensive learning is there. Good, good. How the language is viewed? Yes, language. How language is viewed? Of course, for communication. Which areas are emphasized, highlighted? Vocabulary, good. Pronunciation, fine. All right. And there's a shift from grammar to belonging. All right. Fine, fine, good. So this is all, my dear students, we talk about today, that in this short lecture. Oh, yes, we also talked about activities. Fine, good, good, good. On purpose, I didn't tell you. I wanted you to tell me. Good. We also talk about techniques. Which techniques talk about? Yeah. Yes, students have their voice recorded. Then there is what? Transcription. Then there is what? Group works are there. Small group works activity were there. So all these activities. And then there's also human computer. Teacher works as a human computer. In fact, he helps the students, in fact. Is that clear? So dear students, these are some activities we talked about in this lecture today, lecture number 15. I hope you have caught the idea. I hope you have understood these things. And I tell you that once you finish this lecture, read again this CLL method. Read this and things would be clear to you. Any questions? What is human computer? Oh, it's a good question, right? There is an answer to it. Simple word, computer. It's a machine that computes. But if a computer does it for you, you call it computer. If a person does it for you, like human computer. So here you have your instructor. See, they work as, okay. Who is Curran? Yeah, again, it's a good question. Right, he's a psychologist also. So he gave that the theory, of course, adult learning approach. So from that, this CLL has been, CLL takes principles of Curran's theory, in fact. And he talks about non-defensive learning. And how many elements? Yes, there are 6 elements. Is that all? No question? Okay, thank you very much, students. See you in the next class. Till then, it's Allah Hafiz. I thank you all.